Morning, Calvary Chapel. How are you today? We had a logistic problem that we took care of.
Blame
Lou. We are. Here we are. Yeah, blame the producer. Come on, we did everything we're supposed to do. Good morning and welcome to Thursday Morning Devotional for Thursday, July 23rd. Wow. 8 days left in July.
My goodness.
I hope that you're doing well. I hope that you're hanging in there and going through this pandemic, isolation, social distancing, mask wearing frenzy. I hope that you're doing okay. We pray for you and hope that you are well this morning.
That was a mouthful.
That was a mouthful. Let alone riots in Portland and all kinds of federal agents going here, going there. The governor of Pennsylvania saying hell's going to freeze over if he lets federal agents come into his state and all, you know. It's getting really wild out there, gang. So I think that today's topic is quite poignant. And I think that we'll read through that we have a devotion this morning that we have again gleaned from Pastor Chuck Smith. In his devotion, a word for today. We look at many devotions during the day. I like different readings, but the Word of God is the best devotional you could use. So we do liken everything to the Word of God. So without further ado, let us begin with some prayer. So let's bow our hearts before our gracious and heavenly Father. Oh, gracious Lord, as we come to you this morning, we thank you, Lord, for drawing us close this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the great breakfast and fellowship the men had this morning over at the flight deck, Lord. Bless that group over there. Bless our waitress, Tracy, and all those who waited on us and did various things over there. Bless that establishment, Lord. Continue to provide for them, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that they're open and we can go there, and they take good care of us. So we're thankful for that, Father God. Lord, we look now to this devotion time, Father God, that let it be a time when we draw close to you. Let it be a time when we can open up our hearts, Lord, and receive anything that you might speak to us, Lord. Your word says to be still and know that I am God. Help us, Lord, to be still and hear your still small voice in our hearts, Lord. Lead and guide us by your Spirit, we pray, that you would just continue to show us and guide us into all endeavors that we care to take today, Father God. Oh, Lord, how we want to be more like you and how we want to submit to your Spirit as your Spirit dwells within us and is changing us from the inside out. So, Lord, I thank you, Father God. I ask, Lord, a blessing now upon Pastor Mark and myself, a blessing upon Lou as he does the production. Lord, I just ask, Lord, that you would guide us, Lord, in your word as we can just speak your word clearly and truthfully, Father God. So, Lord, thank you for this day, Lord. We are completely blessed by you and all that you do and who you are. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So this morning we've chosen the topic of forgiveness. And actually we didn't choose it. Pastor Chuck chose it. And we're just happening to curtailing along with him. And we're looking at Mark 11, beginning in verse 23 through 26. I'm going to ask this Mark, Pastor Mark, if you would read that through, please.
So Jesus answered and said to them, "Have faith in God. For assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed, be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you will have them. And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses."
Ouch. Yeah, I was sailing along smoothly until that last verse. Things were looking pretty good. So I'll read what Chuck has to say, okay?
Yes.
So this is what Pastor Chuck writes in his devotion for today. He uses 11:25, the one that we just read. He says, "Our bodies are amazing. Within the chemical laboratory that is you, different emotions cause different chemical reactions. As Proverbs tell us, a merry heart does good like medicine."
Amen.
Proverbs 17:22. laughter and happiness have healing value. Yes. But the opposite is also true. Bitterness and anger create destructive chemicals that begin to destroy our health and our well-being. He says, resentment is destruction. Yes. When we carry hurts and offenses with us, our bodies suffer. It doesn't matter if you are justified for being angry. It doesn't matter if the other person deserves your resentment. The fact remains that you will hurt yourself when you hold on to resentful feelings. The offense may seem unforgivable, but you still need to forgive. Some wounds run so deep that it seems impossible for us to forgive, but it is not. Your Father can help you. Just hold the offense before Him and ask the Lord to free you from the anger you're feeling and the desire for revenge. Ask the Lord to help you to forgive the offender just as He forgave you when you were undeserving or unworthy of His forgiveness. Remember, Jesus did more than just teach forgiveness. He practiced it. As He was being nailed to the cross, He prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do," in Luke 23:34. Don't let bitterness destroy your life. If you want to bless Jesus, others, and yourself, forgive. Wow. So I'm going to leave and let you take care of this one.
Yes.
Wow. Yeah. The first thing that comes to my mind is, of all the things the disciples asked Jesus, of all the questions that they asked Jesus, the one question that really sticks to my mind, the disciples asked Jesus how to pray. How should we pray? And Jesus taught them this wonderful prayer that we call the Lord's Prayer. And even in that, and in Matthew 6:12, Jesus is teaching the Lord's Prayer to these disciples. He's telling them, pray in this manner. And one of the verses says, "And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." So right away, He strikes a chord in forgiveness. Yes. Forgiving being a model, not only that He talked about, but that He practiced. As He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The very ones that were nailing Him to the cross, the very ones whom He was dying for, their sin. "Father, forgive them. They know not what to do." He says, if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. And, you know, this sounds conditional. It sounds conditional when you think about it.
Yeah. We have a choice.
Yes, we do.
Here, and the condition is, if you forgive, you will be forgiven.
Right.
And if you think you don't need forgiveness, you have to inventory and ask the Lord to show you your heart.
Amen. There's that mirror that we're always talking about.
Yes.
That you lift up and look into your heart and say, okay, where have I erred? In what way have I erred? And where do I need to seek forgiveness? Where do I need to act forgiveness? And where do I need to practice forgiveness? Yes. On those that have hurt me, those that have done things towards me. Because, you know, this Devo that Chuck wrote is so powerful, because if you hold on to bitterness, if you hold on to anger and resentment, if you're seeking revenge, that's going to weigh heavy on you.
Amen.
And it becomes a physical problem.
Yes,
it actually becomes physical, because then all of a sudden you have a headache. All of a sudden your stomach is upset. All of a sudden, you know what I mean? And it becomes physical because you have this burden of unforgiveness. And Jesus is basically saying, listen, guys, forgive.
Yes.
Forgive. Forgive. And, you know, Peter caught the idea. And Peter looks to the Lord and says, Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother? Seven times? And Jesus looked at him and said, well, that's a good start, Peter. Yeah. But you really need to forgive him 70 times 70. So I can imagine Peter saying, okay, that's three. You got 486 to go, or 87 to go, you know. But yeah, we're not supposed to keep a record of wrongs. I mean, in the love chapter, love keeps no record of wrong.
Amen. Amen. And just like our Heavenly Father has forgiven us when we ask and repent,
amen,
it's as if we never did it.
Right.
He doesn't wait to see if we're going to do it again.
Right.
He doesn't hold on to a little bit of a thought. Let me keep my eye on them. Forgiveness and move forward.
Yeah.
And that's a blessing from the Lord.
Amen. Amen. And go ahead. I'm sorry.
And you know, Pastor, I was thinking about when we don't forgive and we stand in prayer and we wonder, why didn't we receive like the scripture says, if you believe, you shall receive. Well, have we inventoried our heart? Are we hating our brother? Are we in unforgiveness towards some past hurt? Are we resentful? Are we clinging on to the things that bind us and are a yoke around our neck that can become just like any other addiction to drugs or alcohol?
Amen.
That anger, resentment, and hatred becomes just like a drug.
Amen.
And it becomes so hard to let go of, and you feel justified, and that weakens our faith.
Right. And then if we hold on to that anger, it says, be angry and sin not. If we hold on to that anger and we turns into resentment, we're in sin. And praise God, in 1 John 1:9 that we talked about, if we confess our sins, he, Jesus, is faithful to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Thank you, Lord.
The advocate with the Father when we do wrong. See, the crazy thing about it is Jesus knows we're going to fail. And he's given us every single out possible. He's given us every single way back to the Father possible. He knows we're going to fail. He knows we're not going to be able to stand strong. And he knows that this is one of the difficult things. Unforgiveness splits churches. Unforgiveness splits families. Unforgiveness splits marriages. Unforgiveness splits households and friends. And unforgiveness continues to pour out. Unforgiveness has split a nation. And you see it in our lives.
Yeah, and it splits us internally from our relation with God.
Yeah.
We start pulling away from God and majoring on the resentment, the anger, the unforgiveness, the justification that I am justified in feeling and being this way.
Right.
And that is a yoke of bondage
Amen.
That weighs you down
Amen.
And will take you out.
Amen. And the answer is sitting before the Lord and coming clean. Sitting before the Lord and saying, Lord, I did this thing. I'm guilty of this unforgiveness, and I cannot in my own flesh forgive. Help me to forgive those who have trespassed against me. Help me to forgive those, please. And we sit before him, and then as you do that, he starts to minister to you, and he may give you a time where you go over and apologize to someone for something you might have said or done or whatever, but you ask that forgiveness, and then you forgive that person in your heart, and you drop it and let it go.
Amen. Amen.
Right. You don't hold a record of wrong.
Amen. And you know, when you think about it, our ego is what we're paying attention to more than our spirit. Of the forgiveness that the Lord gave us, of the gratitude of his grace, his mercy, his love, of the salvation that he bought and paid for. And instead, our touchy, fretful feelings and our changeable emotions are being invaded upon in our minds. Renew your mind. Be ye transformed by the renewing
Amen.
Of your mind.
Amen. Amen. And I love what Chuck said, and you mentioned it just a couple minutes ago, that when we carry these hurts and the offenses, our bodies suffer. And Chuck said resentment is destructive, and it doesn't matter. Your anger may be right.
Yeah.
You may have reason to be angry, you know, but you're hurting yourself by holding on to that. You're hurting yourself by holding on to that resentment and that anger, and it can fester, and it can builder, and it can turn into a root of bitterness.
Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir. And that root of bitterness, I have bitterness carries throughout every decision, every relationship, every view of life because of that root of bitterness.
Exactly. And you end up treating people differently because of that root of business. You end up treating people because of that root. And you have to let that go. It's extremely destructive.
Yes.
You've been angry at a person. You won't forgive that person. And all of a sudden, you get an upset stomach, and you get agita, and you get, acid reflux, and all that stuff happens to you because your insides are in turmoil because of simple forgiveness. Now, I'm not making light of your problem, and I'm not making light of your hurt. I'm not making light of that, and I'm not saying that this is the easiest thing since sliced pie. I'm not saying that either, because it's different. It's like, you know, when the Fonzie had to say, I love you, Remember? He couldn't say, I love you. It's like when we have to say we're sorry. We're so, you know, it's hard to get those words out. Because what has to happen is you have to humble yourself.
Amen.
You have to humble yourself in the eyes of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Amen. You have to humble yourself before your brother or your sister, and the Lord lifts you up. It takes a humbleness that you have to do. I'm sorry. I didn't mean any offense. I'm sorry. Or I'm sorry I meant offense, and please don't be angry, you know.
And you know what you just said, Pastor, Colossians 3:13 says, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do.
Amen.
And he finishes it by saying, but above all these things, put on love.
Put on love. It comes back to love. It comes back to the one thing. Love covers a multitude of sin. Love, perfect love casts out all fear. It's the love of Christ that constrains me. It's the love of Christ that compels me. It's the love of Christ that is in me that I can share with others when I'm truly submitted to him. And you know what? And I'll be the first one to admit, sometimes I don't. Sometimes I just don't. And it bugs me and it drives me crazy. But then when I get back to the Lord and I see myself in that mirror and I look in that mirror and I go, uh-oh, I need to correct something. I need to correct a wrong in me. Because I can only correct me. I can't correct anybody else.
Exactly.
I can't correct anybody else. Right. Even if they're wrong and they hurt me, I can't correct them. I have to look at me first.
Right.
I have to look at me first. And you know, it's interesting. In the verses that we use for communion, there's a scripture there that talks about making up with a brother. You know, for this reason, many of you, if you judge, where is it? It says, it talks about making up with a brother. It talks about eating unworthily.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
When you go to the table. Yeah, when you go to the table, and if you have something against your brother, you should go to your brother, and you should get that cleared up before you come to the table.
Yes.
You know, here it is. Now, in giving these instructions, I do not praise you, since you come together not for the better but for the worse. First of all, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe, and in part I believe it. There must also be factions among you, that those who are approved may be recognized among you. Therefore, when you come together in one place, it is not to eat the Lord's Supper. In eating, and one takes place. That's not what I was looking for. There's a scripture in there that talks about going to your brother and making amends to your brother as before you take a communion.
Yeah.
And there are churches that I know that actually before you take communion, they say if you have anything against a brother, go see them right now before you take communion. And they actually have a little practice like that. I've seen that happen before. But you have to be careful. So that's talking about taking communion unworthily.
Amen. Amen. And it makes perfect sense that we're going to receive this act of remembrance of Jesus Christ, and we're going to have bitterness and hatred in our heart. When you remember Jesus, you think of the love. You think of the forgiveness. You think of the works. You think of the Spirit in the Word of the Gospel. And we're going to go there with hate and anger and resentment. Put it at the foot of the cross.
Amen. Amen. And then leave it there. And that's the hard thing, because we pick it back up.
Oh, yeah.
You know, we pick it back up.
Yeah.
And then what happens is that you have a trouble with the same person or that, and then you remember all the other things that happened in the past. It's like, well, they're done. They're gone. Move on.
Yes.
You know, move on in your life and try to, you know, forgive as you've been forgiven. And then that means looking in that mirror and realizing just how much you've been forgiven.
Yes.
Man, when I think of all the things that he's forgiven me from, who am I to hold a grudge against anybody?
Amen. And if we are honest with ourselves in inventorying our hearts and letting the Lord show us those thoughts, those reactions, those sarcastic nastiness that we want to rise up and become a part of or let become a part of us, we need to ask forgiveness of that too. As Amen. Much as it sounds like we're jesting, what's in our heart? And a lot of times, if you're sincere with the Lord and yourself, you'll see it's anger, it's resentment,
Amen.
It's a root of bitterness.
Amen. Amen.
And you know, Pastor, I have here Ephesians 4:31-32.
Okay, read that.
All right. It is, let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you.
Amen. Amen. And, you know, it's a process, you know, because I'm still covered in this old nature. I still have the old nature in me, and it's alive and well. Unfortunately, it's there.
Yes.
And it's at enmity with the Spirit. There's a battle going on in my heart and in my life. There's a battle going on for control of this body. And sometimes I lose the battle. But Christ has already won the war. You may lose a battle here or a battle there, but the war is already done. The victory is ours in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And we can overcome this as long as we continue to abide in Him. That doesn't mean you're not going to slip up. Doesn't mean you're not going to have problems. Doesn't mean you're not going to have resentment now and then. Doesn't mean that. However, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just.
Praise God.
We have that advocate. We have to continually go back to the cross. Continually go back to His love. And as we seek forgiveness, He shows us that we also have to be forgiving.
Amen. And you know, if you're on a soapbox, I'll speak for me. When I'm on a soapbox proving that I have every right to feel the way I feel, justified for my anger, righteous, self-righteous indignation because I am been hurt and you've done me wrong, I'm in self-sufficiency and God has pushed away in that. Because it's when I'm weak that He is strong. And
Amen.
When I'm weak is when I'm willing to admit I'm sinning.
Amen.
And I need you, Lord.
Amen. And I remember you teaching this on a Monday night, and we've heard it before, even before you taught it on the Monday night. What good does it be do me to be right and lose a brother or a sister?
Amen.
What good does it for me to be right and offend a brother or a sister?
Amen.
You know what I mean?
But
because of that old nature, like you said, man, don't push me off my soapbox.
Yeah.
You know, let me be on my soapbox. Don't try to get me off my soapbox.
Yeah.
Well, of course it's pride. It is pride. Absolutely.
Yeah.
The whole thing, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, the pride of the flesh. It's pride. Pride comes before a fall. All those things that pride cannot do. And pride keeps us from Christ. That's why humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and He will lift you up. You know, and the moment I said I don't have any pride, I have fallen because I have pride. You know, the moment I say I don't have any sin, I'm done because I have sin. Or the moment I say I don't have any unforgiveness, I'm a liar.
Amen.
You know, but I'm not because Jesus Christ has paid for those sins.
Yes.
And in Him I am free. So.
And you know, gang, if you're carrying some past hurt, some past resentment, some past betrayal, some past abuse, I understand. We understand. But it's killing you if you continue to carry it.
Amen.
And we don't make light of this. We feel your pain. We sympathize, empathize, and above all, Jesus Christ does.
Mm-hmm.
Now, don't let it consume you any longer.
Amen.
Please, leave it at the foot of the cross.
Amen. Amen. So, wow. A lot to chew on. You can do a word study on two words, the word forgiveness and the word forgive. You can do a word study on those two words in the Bible, and you'll be busy for hours, you know, just doing that word study on the word forgive and the word forgiveness. So, that would be a good time, good reading. So, but I've already given you an assignment for your summer reading, so don't, you know, do that, you know. So.
It's a good assignment for my wife.
Oh.
I kid.
Well, you have to go home today.
Yeah.
I know.
Honey.
Yeah. All right. Well, anyhow, let me give you a couple announcements as we close down. We're excited about tomorrow. We have our men's Bible study at 9 o'clock in the book of James 1. We're in the devotions are 11 o'clock. And in between that, at 10 o'clock at 11 South 7th Street, is Ladies in Prayer. So come out to something like that. That'll be good. Don't forget, on Sunday at 10 a.m. is Santos going to be here at 10 a.m. to do the service on Sunday morning. I'm excited about that.
Santos.
After service on Sunday afternoon, we're going down to the Lighthouse at Cape May Point for our picnic. We're asking you to bring some salads and some sides and things, or desserts and others. Everything else will be provided for you. And we believe that Santos will be there also. So that'd be a lot of fun. The next ladies' breakfast at Flight Deck is on August 3rd. Oh, I can't believe I'm saying August. But don't forget Monday night, Freedom Through Christ at 7 o'clock right here with Pastor Mark and his wife Rini leading that. Wednesday night, it really starts to heat up, folks. We get into episode 4 of The Chosen. And if you really want to find out what's going on in episode 4, read Luke 5. Luke 5. And then back to Thursday morning where we have our men's breakfast over at the flight deck and a devotional time. And I do want to reach out to you and say that those of you who knew our dear sister Janet Tuttle, we will be having a memorial service for her on Friday, July 31st, which is next Friday, at 10 a.m. for visitation and 11 a.m. for the service. So I'm inviting you to that, to come out and pay your respects to the family. So, wow, a lot going on, Mark. A lot going on. Praise God.
And, yes. Thank you, Lord.
If you're in need of in anything, please give us a call. Call the church phone, 609-884-5821. If you have our cell phones, call ourselves, and we'd love to talk to you and help you out. And we hope you're doing well, and we continue to pray for you, and we continue to move forward as a church. So anything else, Mark?
Just that we all have a part in being a part of.
Amen.
So come.
Amen.
Come.
Amen.
Be a part of.
Be a part of it. I like that. We all have a part of being a part of. Right. It's up to you. It's up to you. You can be a part of this ministry if you choose to be. So want to pray us out, buddy? Please. Or you can read Chuck's prayer. That's good.
Chuck's prayer is beautiful.
It is beautiful.
Heavenly Father, although we have sinned against you again and again, you have forgiven us again and again. Help us be like you.
Yes, Lord.
Help us to forgive as we have been forgiven.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, we'll see you tomorrow. God bless you guys.